This panel, I will venture to say, may be one of the finest in this very fine two-day event, and it is about intelligent systems. It's no accident that one of the most intelligent people in Santa Fe, David Krakauer, is both involved in it and sort of moderating it, although we hope it's going to be more of a free-for-all. David, I think, requires no introduction, and therefore I won't give him one. Vanessa,
good, man.
Yeah. Vanessa is many things, but has been an anthropologist, studies cognitive systems, and recently, as I understand it, studies information flow through evolutionary processes. We also have Graham Spencer here with us. Graham, most importantly, is on the board of the Santa Fe Institute, but secondarily is a venture capitalist at Google Ventures, and he became so after selling a company that he had founded to Google, and that was just one of many businesses that he's been a part of building. Jonah Nolan is a personal friend. Very excited to have you here, Jonah. Jonah is from Los Angeles, and his discography and bibliography and what is television equivalent?
Cinematography.
We'll take that. Yeah.
His Scientology are extensive. But if you watch, for example, Westworld, or if you've seen The Prestige, or Memento, or The Dark Knight, or Interstellar, you've been lucky enough to enjoy Jonah's work, which deals with a great diversity of scientific and theoretical topics. And finally, but most importantly, I'm trying to find your bio. Kurt Squire. Everyone give it up for Kurt Squire.
Yay.
And Kurt comes to us from UC Irvine, where he is a professor of informatics and studies in particular the potential of video game-based technologies to reinvent education in the way that we learn. Welcome our panel.
Fantastic. Is mic working? You can hear me? Wonderful. So I'm just delighted to be here with all of you and with this incredible group of people who I have huge admiration for. And we're just going to be discussing something that's very precious and very rare in the world, and that's intelligence, as opposed to stupidity, which, as Harlan Ellison said, is the second most common element in the universe after hydrogen. So hopefully we'll touch on both over the course of this discussion. And I'm going to kick it right off, and we'll just be covering a whole range of issues, from the issues of intelligence at the individual level, how it's made possible by culture, how we fail and succeed in education, how we represent it to society, the nature of collective intelligence versus individuals, and on and on and on. And of course, AI. So, there are a few questions that are going to be targeted, and then there are going to be questions that are open. But I just want to start with Vanessa. Vanessa works on cumulative evolutionary processes. And so, Vanessa, sort of, what makes intelligence and intelligence in our species or any species possible in the first place?
Well, first I want to say that there are many types of intelligence. So if I gave you 6,000 pine nuts and told you to go bury them in the Santa Fe forest over 100 acres, and then I told you come back in 1 year and go get them all, you would not be able to do that. But Opinion Jay would entirely beast that task because they have incredibly good spatial intelligence. So if you ask somebody to describe, if you pick somebody and say, tell me what intelligence is, I think a large part of what they'll say, what they'll do is they'll describe themselves. So if you ask a species to come up with a theory of intelligence, what you're going to get is a theory that tells you what their intelligence is. So when we're working with human intelligence systems, I mean, we have this like human-specific, human-centric view of what intelligence is. And I think that throughout this panel, in the back of our mind, we need to think about, well, what are other types of intelligence that are out there?
Yeah, and actually, so let me just move straight to Kurt on this, because you're an expert on technology, computation, gaming, and education. And education is nominally that machine that we built to allow for the cumulative transmission of the best of our culture. Why is it so difficult? And are there prospects out there for doing it really well? And if we're going to send education out into space, what form of education are we going to be transmitting?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's built for that, but it's also not, right? So it's built also for sorting, which is a lot of what we do, is sorting who's going to get which jobs and which not. It's also for credentialing, right? We worry a lot about that. And then also, I think, enculturation. I think right now we're even seeing in particular maybe an understanding of the role that things like education, that even myself I'd love to slag on, or even like traditional media channels have done in enculturating us toward a common culture, so we have a shared understanding of things like what's factual and what's not. And education, for all of its kind of troubles, is something that's done that to a degree. But I think that where I'm particularly excited, but things it hasn't done, right? So things it hasn't done is done really any good at helping people, not any good, but it's not a system you would pick for developing passion, developing distributed expertise. You know, most learning systems, you'd think, well, I should probably become better than the teacher, or at least decide what I want to learn today before graduate school, right? Which is right now kind of the way it works. So a lot of my interest has been, how can we create new distributed kinds of systems? How can we create systems that look a lot more like the systems we have in the real world, where if I want to become an expert, like I'm a harmonica player, if I want to get better, I can do a lot in the real world between videos and affinity groups and so on. And so I think thinking about how we can create our next generation systems to do that, but that can take advantage of some of these systems, but then also maybe do better than them, because we also know the wild west of these learning systems can also be kind of weird, right? There's a lot of issues in terms of toxicity and how people treat each other that we may not want to emulate. But there's a whole bunch of opportunity, I think, right now.
But would you argue that, is it just a matter of time before the most intelligent way of becoming intelligent in a variety of different ways is by machine instruction as opposed to human instruction?
I think it's going to be a hybrid system. I mean, I think you're going to continue to see machines play a greater and greater role as various forms of coaches and things. But we know there is something particular to human bonds, and in particular to the way that we learn from and with each other. There are neurological studies, you know, looking at how you receive information and feedback from a valued mentor who is a kind of person that you emulate and care for. You know, a caring mentor is one of the most powerful things you can do. Again, it's ironic that in school we don't have them, right? Like, how many kids go, oh yeah, I go to school because there's a caring mentor. I mean, sometimes there's a teacher relationship. If you think back to your best experiences, that's usually what it is. There's a teacher that you cared for. Right. So I think that you're going to have a hybrid, but where you're thinking with machines being more coaches. I also do think there are some things we could probably do to have virtual, you know, agents that will help coach you and bring and give you a version of that experience relatively easily. But I don't think it's ever going to replace those human bonds.
So let's talk about the man on the panel who wants to replace the human bonds. The evil empire itself, Google, Graham Spencer. And Graham and I have had arguments over the years about this. So Graham is a total fanboy for neural nets and deep learning, and has been proven thus far to be completely correct, and I've been proven to be completely wrong. And so every task that I thought would just not be susceptible to the kinds of techniques that have been developed recently have yielded. And so I think, Graham, if you just maybe introduce a little bit some of these ideas of deep learning and how very simple reinforcement schemes have given rise to unbelievable success stories.
Sure. Thank you for that introduction. The basic idea with something like a neural net or with any machine learning system is that you give it a bunch of examples. So you show it a bunch of pictures of cows and a bunch of pictures of sailboats and a bunch of pictures of cats. And you have a carrot and a stick, and every time it makes the correct judgment, you give it a carrot, and every time it makes the wrong judgment, you whack it a little bit with the stick, and over time it adjusts its internal numbers, its internal weights, and very slowly begins to learn the things that you would like it to learn. And for a long time it was believed that that system was fine for learning really, really simple things, but could never possibly learn to actually identify images, or to play the game of Go, or to translate language. But what we've started to see is that through a combination of techniques, basically learning on the part of the researchers, and a combination of just massive, massive computational scale, we found that lots and lots of things that we thought were not learnable turn out to be learnable in that kind of system. So now we have machines that can translate human language. They can identify images in a picture. They can even caption a picture. There are neural networks now where you can show it a picture and it will say, this is, you know, a young man riding a skateboard through the park, right? Things that even 10 years ago I think people would have thought were impossible are now definitely feasible.
Yeah. And so, just to round this out, Jonah, I mean, I think two of I mean, first of all, I think Jonah writes the best scientifically informed science fiction screenplays in the world. So that's just, I think it's really true. And so, yes, I mean, really. And so, okay, but I want to give two examples of where you've taken diametrically opposite approaches in your work, and I comment on these. So your robots in Interstellar, not in any sense anthropomorphic, but absolutely full of personality and humor. That's one group. And the other set in Westworld, who are increasingly terrifying us as the series progresses. And I know, because we were talking about this at dinner once, you spent about a year out of this world, out of your world, just reading the AI literature, just trying to give an accurate representation in a form that all of us can enjoy and really appreciate. I mean, just what are your thoughts in terms of communicating what AI is? And clearly, you're split on the matter.
Yeah, I think I find myself torn, as I imagine everyone up here is, on almost a daily basis between a sort of euphoric techno-optimism and a, you know, increasingly callous fear that all of our technologies will inherit all of our problems. We'll carry them along with us. In Interstellar, I had gotten tired of, I talked about this a little bit yesterday, you know, when introducing Forbidden Planet, because Forbidden Planet was probably the first on-screen depiction of an anthropomorphic robot in a capacity sort of, you know, coming with us to the stars, and it's a bracingly optimistic one. He's strong and capable and loyal. And then we went through the kind of Terminator phase of anthropomorphized robots that not coincidentally coincided with, you know, the emergence of robots as a genuinely disruptive force in the labor market, where you started having automotive factories with robots on the factory floor and people being displaced. And unsurprisingly, it sort of tilts towards a little more of that primal reaction to a competitive intelligence. I was interested with Interstellar in doing something that went back to that original idea, right? Of if it all goes the way we want it to, we design these intelligent agents who will come with us to the stars, there is no reason why they can't embody the very best behaviors and attributes that we ascribe to human behavior. They'd be loyal, brave, thoughtful, charismatic. And so with Interstellar, you kept waiting for the other shoe to drop. I said, no, you can trust these creatures more than you can trust the human crew members.
Yeah.
And then with Westworld, we kind of went a different, slightly different direction.
We're going to ask about what's going to happen, of course, and Jonah's going to remain silent. But I want to talk about this idea because I think it's very interesting. One of the issues that I know everyone here is interested in is, and Kurt raised it and Vanessa raised it, which is there's intelligence in the sense that we're all indoctrinated into thinking about, which is intelligence is IQ, right? Which is already a ludicrous test, but let's leave that aside. But we don't really talk about balletic intelligence much, we should. And musical intelligence, maybe. We describe Mozart as a genius in the same way we describe Einstein as a genius, which is interesting. But that's about it. And then there are these characteristics of empathy, as you say, loyalty, sanity. Why aren't we talking about artificial wisdom? And presumably, if we're going to go out into space, I mean, I don't think those aliens are going to be particularly impressed by AlphaGo. It's like, here's the best of humanity. It's like, really? And they're just going to take a torch to the Go board and say, that was pretty easy. And so I'm just curious what you all think about, Vanessa, you raised it with you first, you know, why don't we have empathy for these diverse forms of intelligence? I mean, why are we so obsessed with this one narrow analytical band?
Oh, that's a tough question. I mean, I would just say because we're self-centered. That's the only thing. I don't know where else to go with that.
What about other animals? What about the intelligence of other animals and what we've learned about them and how that might enrich the debate?
I guess I would assume people and scientists would be interested in these other animal intelligence insofar as they're useful. So I know there's been a lot of attention to collective intelligence in ants and termites and stuff like that. Because termites, they seem to be doing something that's cumulative culture in a way. So I researched cumulative culture. I want to point out that there's like two very different senses that you can understand cumulative culture. The first one is just the accumulation of things. So if you look around us, we have tons and tons and tons of things. It's a very like materialistic manifestation of what we think intelligence is. Mm-hmm. And that's the one thing that we can really point to and say is unique to humans. We got a lot of things, right? Mm-hmm. But the other sense of it, so the first sense is like society might have X number of person hours that we can spend making stuff. But the other sense is improvement upon what somebody else has already made. So that's cumulative in the sense that it produces outcomes that no individual could have created on their own. So I could just choose to spend my person hours on reinventing the wheel or adding something to the wheel. So these like termite mounds are good examples. Like no individual termite makes the whole mound. They kind of inherit this modified environment and add to it, and it produces like there's all these like emergent properties that come out of what a termite mound can do as a collective. So in a sense, I'd say that cumulative culture really underlies collective intelligence. So if we want to not talk just about human intelligence, but say something more generally about what is special that humans are doing that other organisms might be doing, like termites or other organisms on other planets might be doing, they might be tapping into this kind of collective intelligence. Mm-hmm. Like the stuff that I've learned, I can package that in some informational form. I can package my knowledge and give it to somebody else before I die. So that knowledge doesn't die with me. It stays out there in this public domain and then can be used for like to take more steps beyond that.
But let me look at since you've given the rosy picture of collective intelligence, let's look at the slightly less rosy version, which is, you know, horribly malicious chatbots or the
Go
sharing.
To Tucson right now.
Right.
You know, the thing going on in Tucson right now is crazy.
What is that? What is that?
Oh, there's a group of people that are convinced that there are homeless people trapping children and enslaving them for sexual purposes. And right now, they're convinced this is true. There's no, this is not happening.
So it's just a little bubble.
Yeah, but there are thousands of people who are dedicating hours to doing this and can't, see the obvious logical problem.
But that's the thing. So let's talk about that. And Graham, I know Graham has worked a lot on issues of bias in algorithms. And so if the data that's being collected is being generated by fallible human beings with all our prejudices, it's just going to reflect it right back at us in a more efficient manner, right? So what are your thoughts on that? I mean, so the negative side of Vanessa's comment of collective intelligence in the new tech world.
It's a huge problem. One of the best examples is in the field of machine translation, where a computer will take a whole bunch of snippets of text, for example, from the United Nations, where you have the same text in two different languages. And it will look for matching segments of text, and it'll build up a giant database, basically, of matching segments. And then when you feed a big sentence in, it tries to find the best matches and gives you a translation. But people really quickly noticed a big problem with that. So if you take a language like English, which has gendered pronouns, and you translate that into a language with non-gendered pronouns, and then you translate it back. So if you say, he is a doctor, she is a nurse, when that gets translated into the non-gender language, it's they are a doctor, they are a nurse. And when it comes back to English, it's right back to he is a doctor and she is a nurse.
Right.
And so it's preserving the gender biases of the source language in a way that people didn't really expect, but of course it's obvious in hindsight. And so figuring out how to address that is extremely difficult. I don't think anyone has a good answer right now, because it crops up in so many different ways. It crops up in facial recognition, where the databases for facial recognition are usually 80 or 90% white, and so they have a 5% accuracy on white male faces, but a 30% accuracy on black female faces. And in part that's because many of the researchers who do that work are themselves white males. In part it's because the database that they use is dominated by white male faces. But almost everywhere you turn, you find these issues. And I don't think anyone knows of a good solution yet. But it really does sort of crystallize and reflect back the biases that we already have.
How are you thinking about the ethics of once these things exist? Like, and how they can be used for things you might plan for or not? Because that's been one of my concerns about all the things that we create, is that once they're out there, who knows what's going to be done with them?
It's a huge problem. I mean, today people can take... So this was a very controversial paper written, I think, just within the past year, where someone took a bunch of faces of criminals and non-criminals, and then tried to build a machine learning algorithm using a vision recognition system to identify whether someone's a criminal from their face. And of course,
that's just phrenology.
Yes, 2.0, exactly. Right? Exactly. And anyone can look at that experiment and realize how incredibly biased and wrong that is. But anyone now can go download the toolkit to do that. And so it's sort of out there. People have done that also to detect sexual orientation, again, opening up an incredible set of problems. And the predictions are almost certainly completely inaccurate. But you can build the model, and you can run the model, and then you can believe the model, and that might make you do all kinds of things. Yeah. So it's really happening now.
Yeah. Can I ask, and Kurt and Jonah, in different ways are reaching out. You know, in a way, you're both educators. It's an odd thing to say, but mm-hmm. But I think it's true. And and you are exploring the hybrid domain, right, which is how a form of intelligence we think we know, our own, is interacting with one that we don't, that we created. And I'm just curious what your thoughts are on those hybrids and in your work how that plays out in different ways. I mean, for Kurt, what does the machine have to be human for us to empathize with it, or could it be unbelievably different? In fact, that might be preferable, actually.
Yeah.
And in your experience, in writing about these things, do they have to be human values? I mean, are there values we could admire and appreciate that are vastly different? I just riff on these kinds of ideas. Mm. I don't know.
I think anyone who's played, say, Final Fantasy VII, and the gamers out there know that you can care a lot about synthetic characters very quickly and easily. We do in games all the time. Mm. Super simple. Have a game, your character do something to help you, and then you usually feel a bond pretty quickly. We've been exploring ways to do these for other purposes. We're working right now, and as much as I am scared, I'm thinking, oh gosh, we're inventing something that could be scary. So we're working on creating virtual agents to help kids monitor their attention and their executive functioning, so ways to help them become better able to manage things like their attention. I do worry, though, at the same time, well, who gets those data? What do they do with them? Do teachers do it? Do parents do it? What happens when devices know your emotional state? One thing I'm committed to, though, is giving people the keys to that in the same way that I think we should be right now more broadly, like in the same way that you should be able to control what happens to your Facebook data and your Google data in ways that we have kind of given up. But it happens even in other systems, right? As a student, you could imagine saying we should be in charge of what happens with your test scores that you take and what the meanings are of that, and ability to be more of an advocate for yourself in our system. So that's something we've been trying to do, is to create social systems that go around that, so that we encourage people, as we come up with these devices, encourage kids to, say, be the ones to make the case for, here's what I think the meaning of this score is, or here's what I think the meaning of this is, so that I'm arguing with my data towards something. But I'd be lying if I said that we have it figured out.
Right, just jumping in on this question of empathy, which feels pretty foundational. Mm-hmm. We're going to need to build it into any form of AGI we contemplate. And for us, we, not on a theoretical level, but in a market-driven level, we had to grapple with the problem of empathy. We're doing a show about robots. Your show lasts only as long as the audience cares about the characters. And we struggled with it on a technical level in the first episode. During the notes process, when people would say things that you couldn't believe they would say, the whole project became kind of an acid test for the people we were working with in kind of frightening ways. But one producer at one point said, well, yeah, they get beaten up and assaulted and attacked, but if they don't remember any of it, does it really matter? Is there really a moral component to that? My wife, who worked in the DA's office and dealt with family violence with children who wouldn't remember the things that were done to them, had to point out that it was still a crime. Right. When we went in to manipulate the performances, largely we have an incredibly talented cast, and the actors who are playing hosts, who are the robots on our show, they would do an awful lot of acting, but we would do a little bit of subtle manipulation. We would slow down the way their facial muscles recovered from a blink. We would make the eyes move slightly independently. Really subtle stuff, and we had to be very careful with how much of it we applied. Humans are really weird when it comes to the question of empathy. I can draw a smile on a volleyball and build a very successful Tom Hanks movie out of it, where you feel really bad where the volleyball gets swept away by the ocean.
I didn't feel bad at all.
No, I didn't care. I didn't care. If it had been a basketball, I might have been more interested. You know, so humans are weird. I can trick you into applying empathy to something that does not deserve it in the slightest. So I have a daughter, and she has lots of stuffed animals, and she'd feel terrible if one of them came to any harm. We're very bad at applying it even to our fellow men. right? Very easy for us to make a distinction. So getting into the mechanics beyond artificial intelligence, how do we sort things out? How do we understand things? This idea of artificial wisdom, artificial sanity, you know, the larger components of what it is to be intelligent, which includes empathy, is something I barely understand it in the human creature.
If we design that artificial wisdom, maybe that's the thing that'll kill the humans finally.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, that's it, you're out.
So let's ask sort of the elephant in the room, right, which is, you know, here we are at the Interplanetary Festival, and it's ideas, and it's art, and it's positive and constructive, I hope. And yet we're living in a world which at the present time seems to be so riddled with prejudice and stupidity and intolerance, and it always has been, of course. But we seem to be going through a bit of a bad phase. And I'm just curious, you know, we're making so much progress in so many ways, right? I mean, every day you pick up the newspaper, something extraordinary has been discovered, someone's done some really amazing work. Why? What are we not doing? Where are we failing and why? Why isn't the culture, to Vanessa's point, why aren't we doing this cumulative culture thing? Why aren't these ideas getting out there to have an honest debate and to reckon with facts and come to a sort of a better resolution? What's going on in the world? Why is it so stupid?
Maybe I'll half answer that by harking back to what you were talking about, biases. And I'll give you some theoretical background for that as a cognitive scientist. Culture evolves by adapting to people's minds. It's something that replicates by passing through cognitive systems, through one mind, through another mind, like that. And in that sense, cognitive biases are selection pressures on culture. So if you can't learn something for whatever reason, there's no way that you're going to be able to teach that, and that's going to fall out of your cultural domain. So you can't expect culture to solve these problems for you. You really need to change the landscape that culture is adapting to, which is our minds. And that's why like language engineering is so bad. It doesn't work. There's a really good example. Actually, there's a couple examples. Like the word Ms., which was supposed to be a gender neutral. It was supposed to be a gendered way to refer to a woman, but not disclose her marital status. I actually saw some application forms from the 70s that had Ms. on there, and this was a new thing. A lot of people didn't know what it was, and they're like, why would someone not want to disclose their marital status? And I saw some applications that actually said Ms. parentheses divorced. And, yeah. And nowadays, of course, we know, we don't use it like that. There's a lot of gender-neutral language, like chairperson is a really good example. Chairperson should not specify the gender of the person who's chairing a meeting. But if you go on Google Ngrams, you should Google that. This is a big database of word frequencies over time. If you type in, he is the chairperson, and then she is the chairperson, you'll have a flat line for he is the chairperson. Millions and millions, billions and trillions of words in English, nobody's ever said that phrase. But she is a chairperson, it's been rising with chairperson. So this is a gender-neutral word that people invented, but then they released it into a population of biased minds, and it just finds its niche. Huh. So we really need to change our minds before we can't expect culture to do anything for us in this sense.
Right, that's great. Stupidity.
Stupidity. Where to even start? we talked a little bit about this. Fascinated by the idea of the Flynn effect. Yeah. Which suggests, for those of you not familiar with it, that over the 100 or so years in which there's been large-scale intelligence testing, that they have to renormalize every 10 years because the population seems to be getting smarter. Now, there's an enormous amount of questions under that. Are they just getting better at doing the test? You know, what do we mean when we say they're getting smarter? What does intelligence, you know, what do IQ tests even measure? But let's assume that on some level, the Flynn effect means that we're getting smarter. It's hard to imagine. I mean, you see a number of different explanations for it. One is nutrition, right? The Green Revolution, the idea that there's far more access to nutritive food possible. I do tend to think and wonder, again, going to the place of humans always tend to see it through their own lens, whether it's technical or something connected to our technological expressions of culture.
Yeah.
It seems to neatly connect to the rise of television. Now, you know, the idiot box, ironically, might be part of this, you know, broadening of the ability for cultures to exchange information, for people to idiate back and forth, this kind of meta level of knowledge. If there is any connection to technological sort of underpinning to the Flynn effect.
It's video games, sorry.
It's clearly video games.
Yeah, yeah. You
asked the next question. I was very interested, David, in a talk you gave in LA last year. We talked about the idea that singularity actually began 70,000 years ago with the advent of spoken language and written language, and the idea that, you know, that intelligence is a shared phenomenon, that we ideate back and forth. And for me, the most urgent question right now is holding open the possibility that technology impacts that general level of intelligence. What's happening with social networking? You know, if that's where most of us are getting our information, if that's where most of us are now exchanging our ideas, those structures have been brought into place by market forces, right? So this larger question of what's ethical, what's sensible, what contributes to the overall good of it, I think is becoming a very urgent question. You can look at social networking as a dry run for artificial intelligence, because largely it's the same two companies who are driving both forward.
Yeah.
Facebook is the second, you know, biggest investor in intelligence behind Google in terms of artificial intelligence. If you look at social networking as a dry run, I think it's been a disaster, mm-hmm. right? I mean, we just look at the last year. Every day this week, there's another article about Facebook. So that larger question of the technologies we make, are they designed the right way to further the overall intelligence of the human species?
And it's really interesting, and it gets to this notion of collective intelligence, something that many of us are interested in at SFI, and that is, it's not obvious, right, that to create a collective intelligence, you just create lots of intelligent components. I mean, ants arguably have much more impressive collective intelligence than us, right, in some sense, but they're not individually more intelligent, so the mappings are rather complex. Now, I know we're running out of time, so I'm going to ask you this one final question, and it's a one-word answer. And that is, if we're going to send into space a species, animal or plant or microbial, that best represents the intelligence of evolution on the planet Earth. That's
ants.
A tough one. but you're going to have to send a colony, Jonah. Which species or individual representative of the species would you send? And I'm going to start, because I know you have to think about this. And it's obvious, and it's a cephalopod, obviously, and probably a giant Pacific octopus. That's mine.
I'd say a spore, because it has a lot of stain power.
A spore?
Yeah.
Of what species?
It's robust to everything.
I mean, what kind of spore?
Or also like a bacterium or something. Something that's just like proven that it's good for it on Earth, you know?
All right, okay, done. Yeah, and take them out when it hits them.
Yeah.
That's right. Graham?
I'm going to be totally speciesist and say a human. I'm going to do it.
All right.
I'm going to go with Douglas Adams on this one and say dolphin.
Nice.
You can't blow up a planet with dolphins.
Good.
That was mine. I could pick a different species, the bottlenose, the ant, I guess, for their collective ability to do work.
Yeah,
or bees, either one. I said ants, so go ahead.
That's books. Well, thank you very much to the panel. Thank you all very much. All right.